We wanted to talk about 25 years ago this week, Muhammad Ali lit the Olympic torch in Atlanta. And I was curious, the backstory of that, like, how did you keep that secret from everybody, including those who probably worked for you?
Well, it started, Dan, a few days before Christmas in, I guess it would have been, the games were in, what, 96? So it would have been just Christmas week in 95. And I was in Billy Payne's office. He was the head of those games. He'd gotten the rights to the games for Athens, or not Athens, but Atlanta. And he, when asked by me who had he decided would light the cauldron, he said Holyfield. And I said, Billy, I just don't think that's a good idea. I just don't think he really has that stature. I know he's a local guy, but there's somebody who's much better for this. And he said, who? And I said, Muhammad Ali. And he said, in all earnestness, he said, Dick, I just think I'll have a terrible time trying to sell that here in Atlanta. And I said, Billy, it's just not comprehending what Ali is all about at this stage of his life. I think he's probably the most beloved person in the entire world, other than probably the Pope. He's appreciated by young people, by people who are now well beyond their youth, who watched his valiant fight for what he thought was right. He gave up his prime earning years. The sacrifices were enormous. He put everything on the line. And to show you how strong he held his opinions, he sat on those sidelines for several years, losing that money. And in the meantime, he really tested out the court system. And he won a unanimous verdict from a very, very conservative U.S. Supreme Court. I think it was 8-0. He was vindicated, and he went back to fighting again. And Billy said, geez, I still don't think I know enough. And do you remember Lisa Lacks, who worked for us at NBC? She was our primary filmmaker, Dan. And she, I said, I want you to make this film. I called Don Hewitt, the 60 Minutes executive producer, and he had done the most recent interviewer. He'd had somebody from his staff, had been in Cuba about 2 weeks before and done an interview with Ali. And Lisa cut all this stuff together through the ages. And we sent it to Billy. This would have been in the spring of 96. And he watched it, and he got a pretty strong sense of, you know, what this real Ali was all about. But he was still a little reluctant. And at that point, I got off the phone and called Andrew Young, who was a prominent member of the board for the Atlanta Games, the former ambassador to the United Nations, among other things, big deal in Georgia. And I said, you've got to push Billy over the line. And within a day, he did. And Billy always, always appreciated that fact. And as Clinton told me the day after the torch lighting, and not the torch lighting, but the cauldron lighting in Atlanta, he said, when Ali appeared, the world heard the loudest hush in human history. Because when he came up over the rim of the stadium and the public saw him, it wasn't initially cheers. It was this kind of enormous kind of sound that was just everywhere. And what a lot of people forget, they spent a fortune building this ramp on the exterior of what became Turner Field so that the athletes could gradually walk up 5 stories and come up over the rim of the stadium, as opposed to in the past, all Olympic ceremonies, they'd come walking in some gate into the stadium. But here they just appeared. And when they saw the athletes coming up and then they saw Ali emerge, it was just unbelievable. And as it was, his courage was on display. And I suggest to people, I don't know how often you'll be seen again now, we've just had the anniversary, but watch as he holds that torch to light the arrow, not the arrow, but the thing that looked like a little rocket that was going to shoot up and light the cauldron. And the flames are licking back across his forearms. Yeah. And I kept thinking, how much longer can he hold this? Because it's got to be burning this, the top of his arms. But he did until the thing lit.